Welcome to Ambedkar lecture series organized by Boston Study Group every month. And this is the 31st episode of Ambedkar lecture series. And I am the moderator for today. My name is Sanjay Bhagat, and I am part of the Boston Study Group. The Boston Study Group is the Ambedkarite organizations from the New England area, which represents all the marginalized community and the discrimination they face. And we invite the lecturers and the speakers from all over the world to give lecture in this Ambedkar lecture series. So today we have Vaibhav Saini, and his book is Innocence Lives in an Array. And that is what we will be talking about today. So when I read cover page of this book, I was under impression that this book is all about LGBTQ. But when I started reading this book, I realized how Vaibhav has unraveled so many dark facets of the life, especially in India. Whether it is untouchability, feminism, politics, blind faith in religions, sex trafficking, issues of Naxalite, Maoist, sold out media, female forticides and infanticides, hollow society life, and many more. Just to give a glimpse, I will read a few lines. Bhaskar wondered why caste and God were employed as weapons, why Hindus seemed discontented even after giving God over 1,000 names, from the Lord Brahma to the Lord Vishnu to the Lord Shiva. Curiously, none among these 1,000 possessed the magic to stop the exploitation and indignity meted out by this higher caste to the lower caste. While touching so many subjects, he did not dilute his main objective of exposing Indian society towards treatment of LGBTQ, a life of discarded they have to live with. Discarded not only from the society, but from their own parents and family. LGBTQ movement has evolved in USA, but Indian society is still in mindset of 19th century. Hopefully, Vaibhav's book will contribute to change that mindset and let people understand that LGBTQ people are also human beings. They have equal rights of living their life honorably and with dignity. This session is going to be more interactive. So first, Vaibhav will tell something about his novel, and then I will ask few questions based on what I understand from this book, and then we'll open forums to the Q&A sessions. So Vaibhav, please go ahead.
Thanks. So that was a good introduction to what the book covers. And so let me start by saying, like, I want to talk about two observations that I had that made me write this book. One was that, so at least like about 10 to 15 years ago, there was this huge campaign of Incredible India. And then came like, say, you know, everybody felt that we were moving in the right direction. India was going to be like an actual world power, right? We've been listening for a long time that we are a developing nation and we are going to be like, you know, we'll be better than this or that. But there are some reasons why these countries that are actually third world countries and that want to become a developed country are not going in that direction. So evolution can go in several different directions. Somehow in India, our propaganda machine is evolving so that we feel we are moving in the right direction. But if you look at the growth, say in terms of GDP or economic impact of that, so that's actually negative. So it's devolving, it's retrogressive evolution. And what happens is whenever we end up losing money or the economy is not working for the people, then we need to find some groups to target. And usually these are minority groups. Now, how we define minority also varies from, say, like who you are talking to, right? So somebody would say, oh, like it's based on religion. Somebody would say it's based on caste. Somebody would say it's based on skin color. But what about like gender expression and sexual orientation? And that touches at least 2 to 8% of the society. So if you look at any population, 2 to 8% of the population is LGBTQ. These people can belong to like any caste. They can have a different skin color. They can have like any religion. So in the end, what happens is like because of their identity and all these other things that affect their life, they suffer a lot. And we don't hear about all of these things the way we should, right? So if you look at, say, Indian movies, or even in America, right? Usually, like, if there's an LGBTQ character, at least until a few years ago, they would be there for the laughs. So that was one motivation. Then the other thing was that I wanted to ask this question, like, what is the cost of dignity? And who gets to define this, right? So dignity for me may mean something different than for somebody else. But at the human level, we all want respect. We all want to feel that, you know, we are contributing to society in whatever way we think we are capable of. And are we giving people enough space so that they can develop themselves, that they can contribute to their best level? So that's the question, right? What is the cost of dignity in 21st century India? Who can afford to pay this cost? And what happens if you can't, or if you just don't buy into the system? So the book centers around two main characters. One is Babudeep Roy. And so his story is a little bit different. I'll talk a little bit about that. And then eventually he ends up in New Delhi and he starts interacting with this other character who is a teenage cross-dresser or transgender. And through their conversation, a lot of issues start to come out. So starting with Babudeep's backstory, his father is so what happens is Babudeep's original name is not Babudeep Roy. He became Babudeep Roy so that he could advance in society, and that's another tragedy, like somebody is forced to do all these things to achieve success. So
in India, we go with this like hereditary vocations, right?
So Babudeep's grandfather was a cobbler. So everybody expected Babudeep's father to become a cobbler. But actually Babudeep's father is an artist, like a painter, right? So he doesn't want to do that. So he asks his father, so Babudeep's father, who is named Papa, he asks grandfather, like, can I pursue my art? Can I actually start painting? And like, you know, like this is like his own father. He doesn't want to say something bad to his kid. And he's like, yeah, if you pursue something with a pure heart, you can achieve success. So that's what he sets out to do. And eventually what happens is he goes through a series of heartbreaks, like people don't want to buy his painting. When he delivers a painting to like this place where a yagna is happening, they say, like, you know, we really can't accept it because you have polluted the painting. You have made it impure by putting your name on it. And because of your caste, it's impure. So we can't use it. So what happens is, so this is a Hindu family, but it's a low caste Hindu family. And Babudeep is a kid, like he's around 11 years old at this point when this is happening. So what happens is that he loses like all interest in school. He drops out of school. He stops painting and he gives up on hope and the discriminatory gods of the Hindu pantheon. Disillusioned by Hinduism, he converts to Buddhism, yet he fares no better than before, right? So he thinks, I'm no longer a Hindu. I'm out of that, that structure. So maybe I can do better when I become a Buddhist. Now, here's the curious part of like Indian society, right? So while Buddhists thought of themselves as an independent religious group, Hindus disagreed, like slaves claiming freedom without their master's acknowledgement. Buddhists, as different from Hindus as Unitarian Universalists from Catholics, got appropriated by the Hindu PR machine to increase the number of Hindus, capture a larger vote bank, and subdue the influence of Ambedkar. Hindus treated Buddhists as untouchables, lower in the hierarchy than Brahmins, Kshatriyas, Vaishyas, and Shudras. Therefore, Papa remained at the bottom of society and in the clutches of Hinduism. So eventually, what this character decides is, you know, like the system is not working out for me. I have changed my religion. I've done everything I could. And yet I'm still at the bottom of the society. But he still wants to rebel. And he doesn't want to become a cobbler. So he says, okay, I don't want to touch these people's feet, but I'll become a rickshaw puller. So, I mean, it's a way to rebel. But clearly, like, he's still at the bottom of the society if you look at in terms of, you know, like what he can afford to do with his life or with his family. So eventually this character gets married and then he has two kids and a wife. So one of the kids passes away because of some reason. And then what happens is like this family goes through some turmoil and then eventually this character basically like just runs away and doesn't come back. So the mom and the surviving kid have to face the world by themselves, right? So what happens is the mom basically tells the kid that we cannot live like rats. We have no money, no power, no future, and we must fight. So this all of this story is happening in Nagpur, And then this family, like this mom and this surviving kid, they move to Mumbai. And what happens is, so like the kid starts helping out his cousin, who is again like by hereditary, his vocation is as a cobbler. So then his mom says that, you know, I mean, your dad rebelled. He didn't want to become a cobbler. So he became a rickshaw puller, which was no better in terms of money he was making and the life we had. But now you have reverted to your hereditary vocation. I don't want you to do that. So let's move to New Delhi where nobody knows us and we can do what we want. So this family moves to New Delhi and then they basically adopt these two, not adopt, like in Indian sense, like, you know, these two kids start living with them who are from a different country and they start supporting all these different places, right? So what happens is, so they move to New Delhi and then there's an interesting conversation which happens. So the mom tells this kid that if anyone asks your name in New Delhi, say your name is Bhaskar Kumar. If they ask your caste, say Kumar. If they insist what kind of Kumar, say you don't know. And if they ask, are you a Brahmin or a low caste, say you are a Kumar. If they raise their voice and ask what is a Kumar, tell them a Kumar is a Kumar. She squeezes his shoulder and says, never ever tell them that you are a Mochi by caste or that Papa, your father was a rickshaw puller. So then this family, they rent a studio in Govindpuri. And if you've ever been to Govindpuri, it's like one of the most unplanned places you can be. So the book says that in Govindpuri, where unplanned streets cross narrow alleys, shared among cows, pigs, dogs, monkeys, and humans, where urine, feces, and spit colored the pavements and fouled the air, where fences protected schools, colleges, universities, luxury apartments and industries from the congested Muslim slums, where loud noises aborted extraordinary ideas, where the chalta hai, anything goes, Indian mantra kept life mundane. So eventually, you know, life intervenes and then like the mom also basically falls to time. And then what happens is, so then like Bhaskar is all by himself in this world and like these two other kids, then they end up leaving for some other reason. So what happens is, so Bhaskar is intelligent, so he starts to tutor people in mathematics, but between school tutoring and course at home, he seldom found moments to reflect during the day. But sadness lurked in crevices and specters arose at night. He often awoke past midnight, covered in sweat and suffered memories replete with loss until dawn forced him to start another mechanical day. On online advice forums, when people posted messages like life goes on, time heals wounds, life is a journey and love is forever, Bhaskar wondered if these people inhabited another reality. Because his life went nowhere, time exacerbated his pain, and life was an untamed horse galloping to one destination, and lost, not love, was forever. Anyone he loved, he lost. He wanted to give up, but he was not his father, who ran away and never came back. He refused to forfeit the sadistic game of life. He recalled his mother's words, we can't live like rats, no money, no power, no future, we must fight. So eventually what happens is, he decides, okay, like, you know, I'm by myself, I need to break out of this chain. And finally he goes through a thinking process and he says, like, I am going to change my name. Instead of Bhaskar Kumar, I'm going to become something else. And his reasoning is this, while Bhaskar Mochi was a Buddhist, Bhaskar Kumar was undecided. Babudeep Roy was a Hindu. So he becomes Babudeep Roy. While Bhaskar Mochi was an untouchable, Bhaskar Kumar was in hiding. Babudeep Roy was a Brahmin. As a Bengali Brahmin, Babudeep Roy was at the top of the Hindu caste pyramid. With the right name, Babudeep Roy sought fame and power. Now, Babudeep Roy is also gay, but he remains in the closet so that he can rise up in his career. Eventually, what happens is he reaches, he ends up like eventually becoming like a primetime news anchor. And then through like this program, one day what happens is a transgender teenager shows up with a gun to his head and says that I have a story that will make you believe there is no God, but I'll only tell it if you interview me on primetime. So then this interview happens and through their conversations, a lot of questions get answered. Like, what are transgenders like, do we respect transgender people in India? And if you ask people in India, they will say yes. If you fill out government forms, they will have male, female, and transgender. And that's all good, right? It's token wokeism. But when you actually ask, like, how do you support transgender people? Like, will you give them a job as a CEO? Will you buy food from them if they open a shop?
then you start listening to the real respect for transgenders. So people say that they can dance on the streets, they can come to our marriages and we will give them some money. But why do they want to become, like, you can't imagine a transgender person as a CEO. And that's such a waste of brain, because maybe somebody is as intelligent as you are, but you are not ready to afford them the space to express their intellectual or like power or like whatever they can do for the society. So then during this conversation or this interview, immigration rights come up and the role that capitalism plays in the society comes up. So I just want to read like two more paragraphs.
I will intervene here. So
okay.
If the audience may be thinking that why if any teenager comes with the gun is in hand and how he is being allowed to do the interview at the prime time, that is something very unlikely, correct? But one thing I think Vaibhav has not told, that this guy has a bag full of the body parts with him. And when he comes there, he started showing all the limbs, correct? So that limbs, and that is what makes that particular interview TPR worthy. That the one kid with all the body parts who has murdered someone is there, and that is going to be a good, at that time he is not being known as that he's a transgender fellow, but all this drama, that is what make this Babudeep Roy, who is very fond of getting the TPR, and he wanted to be very famous. So, that is the reason he is given the interview. So before we move forward, means when Vaibhav, you were telling about this Babudeep's father, correct? That rickshaw puller. So he is a good painter, and one of the incidents from his life is very much fascinated me, is that he's a very good painter and everybody appreciate his painting, including I believe the minister, correct?
Yeah.
And then this minister asked him to paint a painting of a god, and he paints such a nice painting and takes it to the priest in the temple. And when he sees that painting, that the priest started praising him, saying that such a beautiful painting and all this. And then at the bottom of the painting, he sees the name of the painter, which reflects. And you understand from the name itself, we can find out to what particular this cause belongs to. And as soon as they realize that this is an untouchable who has painted Rama's painting, he immediately starts thrashing that intelligent painter. So that is one incident, which it's very much touched me, thinking that how somebody who is a capable or intellectual is being trashed just because they belong to this particular community. Go ahead.
Do you want to comment on that?
Sure, absolutely.
So first of all, the book is fiction, but it's based on some observations, and so the book has several of these events that take place, which basically connect you to all these things which happen to people in their lives, right? This is just one way people get discriminated against. So it's not only because, so one thing is that, yes, this is like a painter who wasn't allowed to say paint, right? But then the other thing I want to make sure is that, you know, that's just one talent. Somebody could also be, say, like a singer, right? But are they given the space? And then again, like, it's, so all of this is happening to, say, minorities, and one of the minorities is the untouchable community. But then also think about somebody who is an untouchable but also belongs to LGBTQ. So if there is some space where, you know, maybe you will allow access to an untouchable person, but you would say that, okay, we can accept you, but not if you are LGBTQ. So it's like we really need to think about it differently, right?
Yeah.
So that's one thing. So then the next thing is, I think I do want to touch upon like this capitalism point that I was going to make, because that will make things a bit more clear. So what happens is, in this situation, like, this guy was not paid, right? So this kid, he delivers the painting, he wasn't paid. And I mean, people have seen different versions of this happening on the street, right? Now, other thing is like, why? So there's somebody who has power, right? They have the money and they can pay you or decide not to pay you, give you like a contract or not. Right? But who is driving all of these things? So usually it's somebody who is setting up the strategy, or like, you know, like somebody, say, like a consultant or somebody, right? So they set the strategy, and then how do they define So, you know, basically, so the world runs on strategy, right? So there are people who do the work, but they're actually people who are pulling the strings in the sense that, so somebody decides, okay, you know, like in the next 5 years, we are going to get here. Then you come up with some objectives, how you want to get there, and you find people to do that work, right? So you can, so the people who are making that strategy actually drive the world, right? So now the book also talks about like one of these, so what I want to cover here is basically, I want to expose this thinking of like strategizing to utilize another human being's talent, right? So now this is something which was shared in during the interview by this transgender teenager. So this transgender teenager grows up in Haryana, which you, I mean, whatever you see on the news is true. And then, so then eventually he starts living in New Delhi because he gets attacked in like Haryana, right? So then he's living with this family in New Delhi. And in this family, like there's one, like this uncle and auntie, right? Like very common terms in India. So one day, like he sees like his uncle is on the phone and, you know, like he's agreeing with all these people. Like somebody is saying that, oh, you know, like we support the secular, so-called secular family, secular party, the Congress, right? And then the next person calls his uncle and he says, oh, I believe in like the BJP, what they are doing with development and all that. And his uncle completely agrees. And then like somebody, like the AAP people call, right? And then they were like, oh yeah, you know, like we believe in the common man, and his uncle says, yeah, I completely support that. We should all be with the common man. And then like this transgender teenager, he goes up to his uncle and he says that, I mean, he's thinking about it, right? So what this guy, this teenager is thinking is, either uncle believed in bipartisanship, or as I realized later, like a Thalika Bangan, like Wormtail from Harry Potter, uncle changed with the changing wind. He said, so he means his uncle. He said as a consultant, he had honed this technique to make everyone feel special. So I said a consultant steered clients towards conclusions they might resist, but the consultant believed logical. So the uncle says, he said, every idea worth trying had already been tried out, and consultants returned these like Hollywood recycled Marvel heroes, and a few worked and a few failed, and the world moved on. I said that was work and this was personal, and what did he truly believe in, right? He wondered, so his uncle says, he wondered why he had to believe in anything. He said, Jay Lalita and Mayawati, Amma and Bhenji, aligned with the Congress or the BJP as needed. So the transgender teenager said, I said, no one respected politicians. So the uncle said, do you think they care, the politicians care? So the transgender teenager says, I think they should. So the uncle chuckles and said, I was a child. So uncle says to this teenager that you are a child and you are thinking like one and you should not debate issues beyond your grasp. So he says, I mean, innocence defines a child. Innocence is a virtue, and innocence easily distinguishes right from wrong. So this uncle says, who is a consultant, the uncle said, men, not children, ran the world, and that, you know, that he just needs to grow up. So I mean, and then the uncle says that these days, innocence was a disadvantage. Innocent got taken advantage of, and respect out of goodwill had become an empty virtue. He looked into the eye. He looked the transgender teenager in the eye and said, money meant power and power drew respect. And money was the greatest virtue and lack of it the greatest sin. He agreed with everyone because he might need one among them in his pursuit of power. He said he was at the top of his field and he clearly was doing something right. So why I read this is just to highlight that, you know, even people who may be in like, say, different strata of society, once they reach a certain level, they start making compromises. So are we true to our like origins? Do we still continue to nurture those people who are still on their path of coming up? And that's very important. So that's the point I want to make. Like, you know, like, so just because somebody is LGBTQ or just because somebody is from the untouchable community, if they reach a certain level, then maybe they start thinking in a way that, oh, how can I accumulate more power, rather than thinking that I rose from this abyss, basically, right? Where there was no light out. Now I am up in the society. Am I contributing back or not? Yeah. So that's the question we need to ask even these politicians who come to us for voting for them just because they belong to our, say, like our group or like a minority group. Like, are they working for you or not? So that's the question.
Good. So you want to go ahead with the story? Or
you can ask me questions.
Yeah. So the questions I wanted to, means it is really very fascinating story, to be very. And when I was reading, I noted the way you use the language. So basically, and I want you to explain something. So one of the sentences, a mother delivers a free baby whom the world imprisons with taxonomy. I want to free you. So what exactly mean by that?
So it's good you pointed it out. Yeah. So this is the conversation. So during the initial part when I was reading, I read that conversation, right, that Babudeep's mother has with him when they land in New Delhi. And she says, oh, don't tell anyone that what a Kumar is, and just keep repeating that you are a Kumar. So this follows that. So basically what happens is, like, we are born, right? So you can't choose who your parents are or in which family you are born, right? So if you are born in, say, like a family which is an untouchable family, then basically your destiny is set in India, right? Or if you are born in, say, like you are a Tata or a Birla, then you have all this access to money and power. So that's what this gets into, right? You know, that a child is free as long as, like, the child is not out in the world. Once the child is out, then we basically imprison their destiny, especially in India with all of the, it's not even India, in America also, right? If you are born in a black family or like a Latino family, your choices are limited. So I think this is a worldwide issue.
That's good. Yeah, that is what I think I wanted to listen about. Second thing is that you already mentioned that the names of this main character has been changed from Bhaskar Mochi to Bhaskar Kumar and then to Babudeep Roy. So why you think that it is important for you to change the name of this character?
So this was kind of a sarcastic take on this whole system. So imagine, like, if he had, so this becomes a big issue in the book later on. So one of the rivals, so once, like, with this Bengali name, like Babudeep Roy, he becomes like this primetime news anchor, right? So this other party wants to completely, like, destroy him or take over his show or TRPs, right? So they say that, oh, we are going to release all this public information that you changed your name. Nobody knows who you are. How can we trust you? So it basically goes to that, right? Why? So, you know, nobody should feel that they have to change who they are. And nobody should feel that, you know, just if they change this one thing about them, that they will have more access to, how should I put it? Like, access to opportunities, right? So this is what it gets into, right? So, but just because he becomes like this Bengali Brahmin, so he doesn't have to answer all these questions, right? So he goes to somebody and they can like invest in him and they will not question that. Mm-hmm. So again, like coming back to America, right? So if you read a name which says, say, like William something, right? Maybe you have a more chance that you will get the interview versus if your name is, say, like something else, right? So it's the same thing, right? When somebody is reading your resume, there are some preconceived notions. So should you change your name or not? So in the Asian community, right? So if you talk to somebody from China, they usually become, say, like Harry or something, right? But if you ask them, like, what is your Chinese name? They will tell you what it is if you really ask them, but they change it. So I don't think we should have to do that, but...
No, I think that, and yeah. Why I ask this question, that in India, the notion is that the talent is decided by your name, right? So if your name is from the upper caste, then you are by birth, you are very, very talented. And if your name is something like the lower caste or underprivileged caste, you are a crap. So that particular notion is there. And that's why, I mean, I deliberately selected this question because I wanted to point to the audience and everybody that is how the Indian culture is working. The talent is basically decided by your name, not the talents you have.
So I mean, that's a good point, right? So that's what I was trying to say. So in America also, like, it's, I mean, if you look at society, so this is a developed country, right? Here, if you see a name on the resume, if it's an Anglo-Saxon name, there's a more likelihood of getting the interview.
Yeah.
So if you look at India, like, which is actually, like, not a developed country, not a developing country at this point, if you look at the GDP, which, like, fell down because of demonetization, right, which this government did. So it's actually a third world country at this point. So it's not surprising that you see all this discrimination based on your name. And I think what it gets to is, so if you have a name which sounds like you are from a privileged background, maybe we assume that you went to a privileged school, so you know more. Right, so it gets to that question, like, how do we ascribe intelligence? Do we ascribe intelligence to somebody who knows about the world? Or we think that just because you have some bookish knowledge, you're intelligent. And the book talks about this also. So at some, one point, Babudeep Roy, who is gay, he asked this transgender, like, how do you know all this? So this character says that just because I am young and I am a transgender, you think I don't know anything?
Exactly.
So then he gives all these examples of, like, say, like Malala Yousafzai, like the girl got shot in the head with all these, right? But so... And then, like, there are all these examples of young people, like, who are doing good work, right? So we shouldn't judge people based on their age or their name or the skin or, like, their sexual orientation or gender expression. So that's what this is. So it affects the untouchable community in India.
Yeah.
But if you look at global scene, like, even in America, we see all these things, like, based on your name, we can basically make a judgment about your intelligence.
So another thing I noticed, and in the beginning I said that I don't know in just 250 pages how you could get into so many issues, but you did it very intelligently. And so one of the issue I found about this child killing at the birth, correct?
Yeah.
And that is, and the way the process of killing the fetus inside has been described, it is so inhuman. And means when I was reading, I was literally weeping. So that is the utter brutality of killing the fetus. Okay. And so, and this sentence, the villagers followed male primogeniture. They celebrate the birth of male offspring, but demand appropriate postnatal death of the female infants. And so that is the main mentality of, I think, I don't know whether, as you are saying, that it may be the universal or it is more like a Indian attitude to have a son and not the daughter.
So I think this is more prevalent in countries that are like developing or third world countries. So, I mean, you know, like somehow if you have a male child, we feel that, you know, maybe, I mean, in Indian culture, we all know how we feel about that, right? So it's not something which should surprise us. And then, I mean, in India, like, say, ultrasound is banned, it's illegal, but we all have heard of, oh, you know, this person got it there, this person got it there. I mean, we've heard stories, right? In China also, like, you can see this. They had this one-child policy, so, and now we see, there was a New York Times story which says that, you know, like, there's this skewed sex ratio in the population in China. In India, if you look at, say, Haryana, so there are millions of females who are missing. They're missing from the population, not because they were born and they died. They were not allowed to be born. Or if they were born, people killed them. So this is actually murder, right? So then these people are going around and saying that, like, what can we do? You made this decision to kill your child, to skew the population ratio. And now you are saying we can't find brides for our sons.
Right.
So it's a major issue, right? So,
and
so that's
it, and this particular problem is giving rise to some other problems, correct?
Of course.
So
I mean, so like there are all these men, right? So in India, like, you know, whole life is like, okay, so we have a kid, we want to get them married, and then like they have a kid and then they get married. So it keeps going on and on, right? So if you don't fit in that, then you're out of the system. Now in this situation, what happens is that, so you have all these males, okay? So nobody wants to send their daughters to these villages, because even I wouldn't, right? Why would I send my daughter to a place where I know if she becomes pregnant with a female child that she would be forced to like undergo abortion or like something would, like the child would be killed. So they're trafficking. So they're bringing in all these, this will sound horrible, but this is true, right? Every country which has power basically derives more resources from those under them. So in India, if you look at it, like, it can't really derive power from America. It won't fly, right? But they can always exploit those like less better of them than them, like say Bangladesh or... So, I mean, so that's where trafficking and all of this is happening.
Yeah, correct. And you explained means the girls trafficking and all these very nicely there. So
it was a horrible thing to write.
Yeah,
I hated writing it.
But that's why people should know what are the consequences of this. We never thought that this male-female ratio, what other offshoot problems it can lead into, correct? And so this is one of the human trafficking is one of the part of that, or the prostitution.
So it's not just women. Of, yeah. So they are bringing in young girls. They're trafficking young girls. So the book describes how this process works and how it is controlled. Like so the book.
Correct. So anyone has any questions from the audience? Would like to? Okay. Sure. Yeah. So, Vaibhav, in the beginning, I said that I would like you to read one para. So, can you just read that para?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah.
Okay. So, I'll give some.
Yeah.
So, this is during the interview between, say, Babudeep Roy and Ragini. So, Ragini is basically addressing a question which was asked of her, and she says that. Recent research proves that traumatic events cause epigenetic changes that are passed down to children. Manthara, so that's the character in the Ramayana, and I'll talk a little bit more about, like, to give you more context after I'm done reading this. Manthara was traumatized and passed it on to like her children. So I'll talk about this a little bit later. Bharata the righteous, Moses the freer, Jesus the endurer, Muhammad the aggressor. Therefore, over 2/3 of humanity is traumatized by their origin. Ironically, they resort to violence for prosperity. They feel possessions equal peace. For example, Alexander the Great, as fluid spiritually as sexually, conquered kingdoms until he reached India and received the gift of wisdom and an arrow. In India, he came across ascetics who beat their feet in front of him. When he inquired the reason behind the gesture, an ascetic explained that despite his conquests, he occupied no more ground than that covered by the soles of his 2 feet, and that he remained a mortal like those he had killed. So Alexander the Great realized that holding land was meaningless because death stripped possessions, including the flesh, which encumbered the soul. In India, he learned the futility of his military brutality. Upon listening to the ascetic, he probably experienced the touch of the divine. He possibly glimpsed the moksha. I do want to add something more here. So I'm not preaching that we all, start practicing religion. So after this paragraph, actually the conversation goes into more and more what religion means and what is God. Why don't people in different religions don't know the name of the God? For example, Christians or Jews and all that, right? So the terms they use, they are not names. They are like cognates or epithets and all that. And why Hindus have so many names for these gods. So the book has 2 parts. The first part is the interview. The second part goes into mythology, which has been completely updated for our generation. So, when we talk about Ramayana and we come to that pivotal scene where Sita has been rescued and Ram basically asks her, oh, walk on these burning coals to prove that you are chaste. Why not reverse the question? Why doesn't she get to ask, you prove you are not sleeping around with somebody else? But we never do. Right? So the book, and then this turns of a young generation, right? So I have adapted the mythology and I've highlighted the role that LGBTQ characters have played in Hindu mythology. So this goes into all of that, and then it basically talks about that, if you want to believe in mythology, that's your that's your perspective or your faith. We don't want to comment on that. But just think about it, if it even makes sense.
So since you talked about this mythology and all these 2 parts, your book is in 2 parts, and second part is about the mythology. So the question comes, how much the stories you told in that second part is true mythology, or how much is you have constructed of your own to make sense for the current generation?
Okay, so that's a good question. First of all, let me just comment on the question. So there's nothing called as true mythology. That's why the word is mythology. Okay. It's a myth. Okay. It's not true.
Okay.
So that's I think what you were trying to get at was how much mythology is actually what we have read and what is what I've reimagined. Yeah. So almost 99% of it is reimagined. The names of the characters are the same, and maybe the overall story arc is the same, but the details have been reimagined for our generation, our society.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, because for example, one of the name in one story is Fat Belly, correct? So
yeah,
and means when you read the name Fat Belly in our mythology, it doesn't go well. So that's why I thought that you are trying to get something from the mythology, but at the same time, you wanted to make it more relevant for the current generation. So,
yeah.
So that is what was my interpretation about this one.
Yeah, so I can comment a little bit about that. So the character's name is Fat Tummy. So what it basically turns into is that, so there's this character and he starts like hoarding money and lands, and then, you know, he starts eating ghee and he starts getting on some weight. Then he says that, oh, you know, like I've exploited all the resources available on this land. And this is a big like change, right? So we are in climate catastrophe or climate crisis these days, and we are consuming the resources of the earth. So every year, we are eating up the resources for the future generations earlier and earlier. So this year it was like, I think by June or August or something. So it's horrible. So basically this character eats up all the resources in the area he's growing up in. Then he says, okay, let me go on the sea and I'll find some other place I can exploit. So he loses some weight because, like, you know, until he reaches this other place, and then he gets exploited and the cycle continues. But this story is called The Merchant of Promises and actually reimagines, like, so in India, we have this Triveni Sangam where these three mythological rivers are together, and like Ganga, Jamuna. So this talks about like their story. And then this also connects to like a story which is like how the river Ganga came down to earth, and Bhagiratha's story. So it basically ties all of these stories together. And so that's what it was.
Correct. So the question is, means now this the story is about the LGBTQ, correct, main character. In fact, both the characters in this book are the from the LGBTQ community, correct? And one of the story, what he tells about the Shankara, correct, because he has some characters in the mythology.
So let me give some context. So let me just give.
So that part I understand, but
okay.
Considering that at least 5-6 chapters you wrote on the mythology, so why you feel giving references to that mythology? And he referred all these mythology during his interview, correct?
Yeah.
So this main character. So why do you think that bringing that mythology was important for you to highlight his story?
So there are two reasons. One is that if you look at the life in India, even if somebody says that I'm an atheist or I'm an agnostic, they really are not, because they will go and they will exchange gifts over Diwali, and they will celebrate Holi. They will participate in, like, say, like all these Hindu festivals. So that's religion in action, right? So religion touches upon every aspect of life in India. And when we are talking about religion, so, you know, we say that Arjuna was a cross-dresser for this 1 year in the Mahabharata, right? But then if you look at a cross-dresser in your real life, do you afford them the same respect? Do you look at them as a human being or as like somebody you are just like mocking? So when you look at Arjuna, you think that, oh, that's a mythological character, maybe even a god. So we have to respect that character. But what is it teaching you? It's teaching you that as a cross-dresser, he was able to save his life. And he, you know, like he developed all these other talents. So that's what this gets into. Like to basically connect, like we don't think about it, right? So if somebody says, so it again goes back to that question, like why, when our mythology has all these LGBTQ characters and there are same-sex gods in temple, like Khajuraho, right? And they are intimate poses. So then why is it that that mentality doesn't translate into when somebody comes out in your own family as LGBTQ? We say, oh my God, I am a liberal, but as long as you are not in my family, why is that? When you are reading all these stories, right? So I think that's a challenge here. And I thought, like, maybe highlighting the role that LGBTQ characters play in this mythology and then connecting it to this interview, which is happening in current times, can bring some change in how we talk about people. Mm-hmm. So that was the criteria. Yeah. And I want to correct this also. So both the main characters are from the LGBTQ community, but they are also belonging to these other groups, right? So Babudeep Roy, so he's basically from the untouchable community and he grew up poor. And as I read, right, if you don't have the money, then basically you don't have respect these days. So it touches upon all of those issues, but it gets more complicated just because they are also in the closet. Mm-hmm. So that's all.
Okay.
Yeah.
And since you said that the story is like a real, correct? So, and when I was reading this novel, the events in novel are so current, correct, that it feels we are looking at the live news. That is what I was feeling. So how much is the novel is real and how much is made up?
So, okay. So again, like I need to correct the question. So it's it's a novel, so it's fiction.
Yeah. Okay.
Right. So it's fiction. And so that's out of the window, right? Now, somebody said that actually fiction is the truest like form of reality. And like a famous person said that it's not me. I'm not that creative. So you can imagine. So I think like these days, because of this attack on intellectuals and what we are allowed to say in public, it's easier to express the reality when you can relate it to a character. So I think I would say it in that way, that when people are reading it, maybe you will feel that this is real, but it's fiction. But it's the fiction, the world of fiction, which allows us that space to express what is real. Yeah.
So, means I have a lot of questions. So, if you have any questions, so please shoot up. Go ahead.
I mean, obviously, I don't know about the book, but just, you know, listening to you talk about it and ask the question, give me some idea of what this book is about. But is it a story of, I mean, you've chosen somebody who's marginalized or the marginalized, right? So not just untouchable, right? Coming from that community, but also gay, right? And then the other person, I don't know the background, but transgender, right? So, like, in India, you know, there's some space for religious or linguistic minority, but for sexual orientation, you know, we're not at that stage yet. So you've chosen to tell those stories. But my question is this story about them, or is it you're telling a larger story of present-day India through those characters? It's trying to get, like, what is the...
So it's a good question, and how I want to address this is this way. So these are two main characters who are having the interview, but the interview is about their lives, right? So gay people or LGBTQ people are not born out of thin air, right? So they are born in families that are, you know, straight families, right? Basically, like, two people need to procreate to produce, like, and like, people have been trying to eliminate LGBTQ people for a long time, but again, like, 2 to 8% population, always there, will be there, no matter what you do. And you can use CRISPR or whatever, but who knows how nature will react to that. So the point is that, so when Babudeep talks about his life, his father was not gay, his mother was not a lesbian, his brother who passed away was, we don't know what the brother was, right? So it's like, it's this family, right? So it's that story. Again, with the transgender character, like, his father basically, like, did something to his mom. I don't want to like disclose that. And then it's like there are all these characters. So it's not like you grow up in a vacuum, right? So LGBT people, they inhabit this world. They are in the minority, but that's all there is to it. It's not like I deliberately chose these two characters. I just felt like this is how the story came out of me. That's the truth. I mean, it wasn't a deliberate choice, but that's how it just came out.
But are you telling the story of present day India through those? Because it looks like
you
have covered a lot of topics there, right? So
Is
that what you're trying to say? I mean, it doesn't matter, you know, what their background is, but their story, You're just who we are as, I guess, as an Indian, as a human being. Is that the bigger story here? So you also mentioned, you know, a lot of like mythology was covered in your book. You also think that are we prisoners of our mythology, the story that we have been told to us? And in a certain way, our present day actions and behavior is also kind of like guided by all the burden of history or burden of mythology that we carry in our mind.
So again, a good question. Let me correct it though, right? So you said that, oh, are we guided by mythology or our history? Again, those are two different things. History is, to an extent, kind of real, depending on who recorded it. Mythology is a myth. So, yeah, but still, like, see, with historical things, you can have a study and somebody can debate it. With mythology, people come up to you and say, oh, it's my faith, F you, right, if you don't trust me. So with history, you can debate them. With mythology, you really can't. It's like this blind faith in things. And so what you were trying to ask is like if there's a burden. So if you read the book, it will no longer be a burden because you will become updated. So let me put it that way. So read the revised mythology.
Any more questions? Okay. So, go ahead.
So, I mean, you mentioned that, you know, we had among Hinduism, mythology, these characters who were gay, transgender, and they were like all over the place, right? So, but then how do we in present time not able to accept somebody from our family, you know, being of that orientation? And we can see that in different ways as well, like people who are supposedly very well educated, come from, you know, academic institutions, and liberal and progressive, you know, they call themselves, but the behavior towards, you know, Dalits, Muslim, even women, right, of their families are horrible. So you see these characters, right? I mean, and they may be well versed in mythology, actually. They're very well aware of all those characters. But that's one thing. That's over there, out there, while my personal life is different. I don't know. I mean, just like that's a story. That's well and good. I can accept it because kind of removed from me, right? So that's a reverse of the question that I asked before. And are we guided by that? I think maybe we go to a temple and pray to that God, a deity, but come out and actually do totally reverse, right? You know, pray to a goddess, but have parricide in the family itself, right? Is that also characteristic which is unique to India? That happens
So there are two parts to this question, right? One is like, just because somebody is going and praying to a god of whatever religion, does that make them do good things, right? I would say that, I mean, we all, right? So I may go to a temple or somebody may go to a church and they come out and they still have to work in the society, right? So if your job expects you to do certain things, you will do them. So I think like there is that thing, right? So just because somebody is praying doesn't make them a good person overnight. And what is a good person? It's situational, right? So then the second part you asked was that like, why is there this disconnect between what we read in mythology and how we behave? And that's what we discussed also, right? That, I mean, if we look at Arjuna, we think like, oh, this is such a wonderful story. He was able to save his life for one whole year just by hiding. So cool. But if you look at a transgender person on the street, you are like, are ye to hijra aa gaya. So then the point is that the book actually talks about that. So there's this mythology of the unknown avatars of the Lord Shiva, which goes into, so it covers a lot of space. So it covers like the timeline of the Ramayana as well as the Mahabharata. And it tracks the life of the Lord Shiva and his wife Parvati. And then through like various avatars tells like how they were both embedded in these like epics, which basically guide like Hinduism and all that. So it goes into more details about that. Yep. But again, like very good observations and thanks.
Okay, no problem. So there is one paragraph I notice and I will read it. The villagers are following the principle of vaccination, like exposing children to pathogens with attenuated lethality induced immunity. Similarly, exposing them to women's torture by men induced immunity against the sickening behavior. Therefore, the villager expected Pappu, it is the name of a kid,
Pappu,
to fall in line.
And it's not Rahul Gandhi's story.
Yeah, to snuff out his innocence and continue the cycle of abuse when he came of age. So, when I was reading this, I realized, whenever I am even on Facebook or with our my Indian friends and all these, they always say that what a culture we have. We are the most cultured nation in the world, correct? And when we see this type of behavior, that how we are training our kids to torture the women when we become elders, we say the correct, we build in the good sanskar, that is what the word they use. And when we see that this type of the sanskar they build in, what do you like to say about that?
So it's, again, like, so these are, I mean,
when you're growing up in India, you observe all of these things. I just want to make one comment about the book. Whenever like a person who grew up in India or is in India reads the book, they say that, oh, this is real. We have seen it.
Yeah.
But whenever like somebody from a different background, say like in the US, they read the book, they say that, oh, like, this is so violent. It doesn't like, you know, why is it like this, right? So I think there's a disconnect between what happens in different societies. Mm-hmm. Now the violence against women or minorities. So let me put it in the right context, right? So whenever there's economic depression or a recession, then we need to find someone to take that anger out on. The easiest groups are those that can be easily exploited or manipulated. So that's like, first they start with the women, then they go on to LGBTQs, and then it starts going downhill from there, right? So maybe in the meantime, they will recover economically and it will all go back. But otherwise, this is what happens. Now, with regard to like controlling women, so we have all heard all these stories, right? Not only among Hindus, like if you look at all these other religions, they do these kinds of things, right? But it's just that the book is about India. So I pointed it out, like what goes on.
Correct, correct.
And I mean, imagine like...
That is the psychophonia to bring to notice, that is how actually it happens.
Yeah.
But at the same time, we like to boast that we are the most... Sanskari people.
So the word we use is culture, right? So if you look, so this is the most interesting thing for me when I think about it. So when you talk to Indians, they say, oh, we are a 1,000-year-old civilization, and the word civilization sounds very, you know, it has positive connotations. But what have we devolved into? Like the whole gist of this civilization is in this one word, cow, and that has transformed lives, right? People are dead because they don't believe in the cow, or they're eating the cow, whereas other people are prospering because they're keeping the cow in an air conditioner room, when people are dying homeless on the street. So, I mean, is this what... So, if you look at the Indian civilization, which is thousands of years of old, like 1,000 years old, right? More than that. So, we say that, what is the essence of this civilization? And one word captures it in this day and age, cow, love for the cow. So, people have lost their lives because of this. And some people are making money because of this. Some people are getting votes on this. Is that right? I mean, it's not exactly, right, right?
Yeah, absolutely. That is, that means... At least we know that the people here are not in favor of that type of attitude.
Okay, good.
So, so there is a lot of history and culture, mythology, politics in this book, right? So can you please talk about your research and preparation for the novel? How much it has gone to that one?
So I mean, when the story started, it was very simple. It was just going to be I wasn't planning to have like all these issues in that, and it wasn't like something which was I planned it out. It just happened like that. And in terms of like reading about like what's going on, so I mean, it's like you log online and you start seeing all these things. So how can you not be affected? And then when I went, so I tried to go to India and I, you know, like visit and see like what's happening. So so this is another thing which I want to highlight, right? Somehow all these NRIs, including myself, feel that we know what is good for the Indians who are living in India versus Indians who are in India. And there is maybe, so we can go about it in two different ways. One is, yes, that statement is true. If you're not living in a place, maybe you shouldn't comment about it. But the other statement is also true. If you are in the middle of a maelstrom, you don't know what's happening around you. When you're outside it and you can compare it to a different culture, you can tell what is wrong. So if you're getting exploited in India, you think, oh, that's how it happens, right? What can I do? But you come to a developed country, you go to Europe, you go to America, you see how people have rights to express themselves, have rights to make a change. And then you look at India and you feel, oh my God, is this like 21st century or what are these guys doing? Right, still going on the street, killing people in the name of like basically an animal, right? So it's just like so bad. So I think as an NRI, you get a broader perspective to look at what is right in another culture and then look at India and try to bring a positive change for your fellow countrymen. So I think I would approach it from that perspective.
This Babudeep Roy and Ragini are main characters in your book. So how and where did you discover this character?
So it was like, I don't know, like it just came out like that. So there wasn't like a pre-planned thing. So yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. And second means now these two characters are the main characters of this novel, correct? And they are very prominent. Still, you chose to write from viewpoints of the multiple characters. There are so many characters around these, like Pappu, Mother, Soy, and all these, correct? And you are focusing on individual and letting his or her story reveal and populate the cultural, economic, social, religious, and political and psychological situation. So can you just talk about that, means how other characters you have used to get into this other issue?
Yeah, so again, it goes back to this thing that, you know, we have a society, and in this society, only 2 to 8% people are within this like LGBTQ category, right? Rest of them are not. But so we are all living together, right? So everybody's life is basically touched upon by so many different things. So that's how I think the book is, right? So these characters, they grew up with other people. They have friends who are not like them. It's the diversity which basically opens up your eyes to the world, right? Diversity brings more culture. So if everybody thinks the same way, does the same thing, dresses up the same way, does the same job, can you imagine how boring this world will be? I mean, right, we need diversity. We need people who can do different things, bring new ideas to us, expose us to new ways of doing things. So I think that was something which was going through my mind.
Okay. So any character in this novel annoyed you?
So this is how I approached it, right? So what I thought was that I will try to love each character.
Yeah.
And even if like they're a horrible, horrible character who does bad things in the novel, I would still try to find out like why they are doing that. For example, there are these characters who are involved with women's trafficking.
Yeah.
And you pointed that out, right? That is related to this issue of this skewed sex ratio in the population of men versus women in India. And even for these characters, it basically says like, why are they doing this? So basically they say that, oh, we just want to make money. And this is the easiest way to make money. If we start a business, we would have to like, you know, spend some time nurturing it. So we just like traffic women. So we don't have to care about like what happens to them. We don't have to care like where we get them. We just get it done. We get paid and we move on. Is that right? Obviously not. But that, I mean, so that's like, these are the horrible. So then there are other characters like, say like this is Zamidar, right? Who owns this land and who does like some horrible things. But then like he has his own story in the sense like, so his wife loses one child. And so then, I mean, we don't know like how that affects people. But again, like then there are these ancestral pressures, like he has to do bad things to maintain his power. So I think like, I mean, there are several characters which are not, say like the heroes of the novel. But I just felt like, you know, everybody is in so much pain. So why like not try to understand why they are doing bad things? And maybe we can make a positive change by addressing those pain points.
How are you doing in time? Okay, so we have a few more minutes. Okay, so there is one sentence in your end. This, the fear of blasphemy quietens inquiries from the discipline, and derision stamps irrelevance on inquiries from non-followers. And this is so relevant sentence today, means whenever we look at the situation today in the social media, correct? If anybody says anything against the ruling party, the next day he becomes the anti-national, he or she becomes the anti-national. And so that's why this particular sentence really appealed me more. Would you like to talk something about that?
Yeah, sure. So I do want to comment on this a little bit, right? So I think like it is important to raise questions to the ruling party, but let's put this in perspective. So Rahul Bajaj said something in front of Amit Shah and that became a big thing, right? But let's look at who is able to raise their voices. So let's compare it to what was before. So I think now what is happening, so I would say that BJP is actually more democratic in suppression. Because now even the rich people are not able to say something. When Congress was in power, only the poor were suppressed. The rich people were running around doing what they wanted. Right? So if you look at India, like, so, you know, Indira Gandhi, she came up with emergency. And then when she was shot by some terrorists, like Congress basically unleashed this horrendous, horrendous genocide against Sikh population. Right? And then just because Sonia Gandhi was not the right person to lead the as a prime minister. They chose Manmohan Singh to basically, you know, get rid of their past sins. But does that, like, I mean, is that absolution for them? So I think, like, just criticizing BJP for this doesn't really handle the issue. So this is the issue with the Indian society. We are used to addressing to a master, and that's what has to change. So I'm glad that Rahul Bajaj and then the lady from Biocon, like, they are coming out and they are saying things. But why is it that only when the rich are affected that it becomes a news, oh, they don't have a voice anymore? Why is it that when the poor are dying on the street, right? Salman Khan runs into somebody on the street, a homeless person. So then, I mean, and then, like, the police and the cop's daughter is going and saying, oh, I love the hero, can you be gentle on him? Right. So that's what I think is an issue. Like, as an Indian, like, as a people, are we ready to ask these questions for those who don't have any power? So go to those who are suffering the most, give them the power to open their mouths and say how their lives are, and then come up with policies and programs to improve their lives. Rahul Bajaj, if he's not able to speak these days, he will still survive. He still has millions and billions, right? Yeah. But imagine the lives of those Muslims or untouchables or LGBTQ people who could not speak under the Congress, cannot speak under the BJP. And AAP is a different entity altogether. Like, that guy keeps fighting with his own party men, so everybody keeps, like, leaving the party. Like, right? So it's like, where are we giving the space to our own citizens to express themselves?
It's not led by any political party.
Yeah.
So how do you see that?
So again, so who is covering this protest? So Ravish Kumar is covering it, but are those, like, main TV channels covering it? Are the?
Why do we even care about the TV channels?
I do care, because how does the news spread?
I mean, news is coming to us in America. That's democratization of media.
No.
Social media is, people are covering their own news because they don't trust the corporate media. That's fantastic, right?
Actually, I have an issue with that. So why is it that we have this corporate media? Media should be funded by the taxpayer money so that they don't address to anybody. And that's an issue which Bernie Sanders has raised in American elections. We need somebody which is equivalent of Bernie Sanders in India. So why do we have this corporatization of everything happening in India? We don't need corporate media houses. And then not all corporate media houses are wrong. NDTV, right? So Pranav Roy, his passport has been blocked by the Indian government.
NDTV also has, you know, railings that they cannot,
yeah,
cross. Right? So you say, oh, we need a party center. Why do we need one person? I mean, this is amazing that's happening without any leader, without any organization. Yes, the question is, how long can it sustain? But it has sustained 30 days, which, yeah, is also amazing.
Amazing.
And these political parties have not done their job. That's why people are frustrated, pushed to the walls. And then coming out. So I see that as a very positive. What you said before, I mean, this is really a breath of fresh air.
So that's a good observation. It's the same thing which is happening around the world. Like, if you look at Hong Kong, it's a leaderless protest, right? But what I'm trying to get at is a different question. So the protest, so Ravish Kumar covered it in a very good segment. He showed all these Muslim women who had never participated in a protest, who were not allowed to walk out of their homes by men. They were allowed to go to these protests.
They were not allowed to walk out of the home without
a male member accompanying them.
No. I come from
so
a family.
That's okay.
You don't know them. You cannot. So that's the thing. That's what happens with corporate media. They project one image, and that's why propagated. That's what we consume, and that's what we think. That's why I don't trust few media houses. That's why this democratization of social media, where all the news can come, right? There is definitely places a heavier burden on an audience to filter out what is relevant, what is not relevant, but at least those voices are coming up. So this statement that you just made is totally wrong.
I disagree, and let me tell you why. No, just wait. So you spoke. Let me now express myself.
Logical, sir. It doesn't make any sense that all Muslim women are not allowed to leave their
house. I didn't say that, first of all. First of all, I didn't say that. And who... So let me finish first, right? You asked a question, you should have the patience to listen to an answer. Okay. So Ravish Kumar interviewed these Muslim women who made that statement. So I am not making the statement. I'm telling you what the women said during the interview.
Now, the other issue is when we have these YouTubers who are coming out with the news, it is very easy for the ruling party to say that this is fake news or these people are being paid by somebody else to propagate this, to come up with this propaganda on YouTube. So that's why having, so, you know, not a corporate media house, but a media house which is trustworthy is important because they have the resources to ask questions. So that's, so I'm fully in favor of people doing this local news, right? That's where the world is moving. Like anybody has a phone, you make a video, you come out with the truth, and that's all good. But that also fosters all these lies on WhatsApp, right? So what happens in JNU recently? So basically all these BJP ministers, they were putting out like these videos showing that actually, you know, the left-wing candidates were attacking the ABBP candidates, but that's not true. So when like an investigation was done, by all, like there's a website in India which comes out with the truth, like this guy does that. So what they showed was that actually the person who was beating belongs to ABBP on the JNU campus, and the people who were getting beaten up were from the left-wing parties. So what I'm saying is it is so easy. So I completely agree with you that it's a leaderless protest. It's good to have people coming out with free news on, like, you know, local people, but it is so easy to manipulate it. So this is a, this is an example. Now, another reason why I think nobody wants to jump as a leader for these women who are protesting, and I think Shahinbagh, I keep forgetting the name of the place, is that, so Shahinbagh. So I think a lot, the majority population that is protesting there, there were some Hindu women who came out and said that, oh, you were just asking. So Ravish Kumar asked these women, oh, you are like, you know, I see a lot of Muslim women. Are you getting support from the Hindu women? So some Hindu women came forward and they said, our husbands didn't want to come here. We are having a fight every day, but we want to support our fellow women, so we are out here. So that's why, you know, so I think like everybody is in support of what is happening, but we need to look at why it is happening this way. Why isn't Congress, which says that we have always been secular, going and supporting these women? Why isn't Aam Aadmi Party going and supporting these women? And then why is it that the Prime Minister goes out and says, when you look at the clothing or, you know, like how these people are dressing, you can... These are all illogical statements for the country which is in the 21st century. It doesn't make sense. And what is even more galling for me is, why do people have to fight in this day and age, right? So why is it that our Muslim like community has to go out and say that, oh, don't take our rights, we are Indians? They shouldn't have to prove themselves, right? So we are telling people you are guilty until you prove your innocence. It's the reverse. So usually in the law, we say you are innocent until we prove you are guilty. In this case, we are saying, no, you are not. The whole thing is so wrong. So
I think we all agree on that particular count. So with that, I think we are, I think, at the end of the session. So any closing statement from you about the book?
Yeah, so I mean, so I hope people like read it, and that's fine. Yeah.
Okay. So in the beginning, I forgot to introduce Vaibhav. So Vaibhav Saini is the PhD, work as an instructor in medicine at Massachusetts General Hospital, Harvard Medical School. And the book which he has written and which we were discussing about, The Innocence Lives in Erie, it is a beautiful book. It means I have read it, I enjoyed it, and I am sure if you read that book, you will enjoy it too. So with that, thank you very much for attending this Ambedkar lecture series, and good night.
Thank you.
Do you have to give him something?